there, everybody. I know it looks like I'm in Minecraft. I'm really in New York City. And I'm going to walk you through what our experience has been in utilizing Minecraft for education. But I think before that, it's important to note that I've long felt that games played a pivotal role in teaching, especially the teaching of students who struggle with school in general, which are the kinds of students that I teach. You see, so many students get waylaid by school, not because it's too difficult or because it's too challenging. No, kids love those challenges when they're in a game, digital or otherwise. But they give up on school because it's boring, right? So I want to always learn to incentivize school and incentivize learning impactfully. My name is Sean Arnold. I've been in New York City public schools for a good long while. And throughout most of that time, for the last 16 years, I've been in New York City's District 75, which is citywide special education for students with moderate to more advanced disabilities. I've tried to learn any tool or technique that could be meaningful for my students, and that's included Minecraft. Now, I was using Minecraft for my students long before it was a Microsoft phenomenon, but since it has become an education edition, it's brought so many new features in, and it's made it much more accessible for a lot of my students, and I'll get into that. But I think a lot of times when we talk about technology and how it's impacting education, we get into like, oh, here's what you do and the button that you click and what do we need to buy and blah, blah, blah. And not enough of background of why it's important, and even more so of who we're focused on making it meaningful for. So I'm going to spend a moment on who my students are, why it's been meaningful for us, and then I'll get into what we've done with it. All right. So our sort of why in our Minecraft story begins with the whole concept of 21st century learning. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with it, the seven C's, as it were, in which instead of diving deep into curriculum, which is not one of the C's, although it's important, we're diving into the skills that our students are going to need, whether my students are going to live in an assisted living facility, they're going to work at McDonald's if those jobs still exist, or if they're going to end up working at Google or Microsoft or any other major technology company that rules the world at that point, right? So they're going to need to learn how to collaborate with other people. They're going to need to learn how to communicate, even if my students use devices to communicate for them. They're going to have to learn to think critically in whatever capacity that takes on, right? Those are the skills they're going to need. So we want that challenge-based learning. That's always been meaningful. And in the way that Minecraft is digital Legos, it's literally, you don't get more creative than that. You don't dive into challenges any bit better than that. And game-based learning as a whole has been shown to be immensely effective, especially for students with learning challenges. Games are just meaningful for bringing students back into the educational experience who've wanted to give up on it. But for me, there's a couple of key reasons why it's been meaningful. So much of learning and education has been about the external, extrinsic motivators, right? That outside stuff. Here's a grade. Here's some stickers. Here's some points, or blah, 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 blah. And that kind of stuff is meaningful for ensuring productivity in the short term, but it kills creativity almost immediately, and even productivity waxes over time. But if you can tap into those intrinsic motivators, those internal things, like a sense of purpose in what you're doing, a sense of play, a sense of connection to other people, if you're into social things, clear goals, a challenge that you've accomplished, that kind of stuff is what drives long-term creativity, long-term productivity, and gets kids to remember stuff they need to remember, right? Games are powerful motivators for that. And beyond that, I think games really help to redefine failure in learning. So that same kid who in Super Mario like falls off the cliff 16 times is gonna jump a 17th time because they learned maybe I just gotta jump just a half second later and I can make it across the cliff, or I have to bounce off that Goomba, right? They're learning from their prior experience, which is literally what learning is, making it meaningful for them, learning to work harder and work smarter, all right? And beyond all that, it's important to note, though, that not all games are equal, right? There's this phenomenon called the chocolate-covered broccoli paradox. And in this context, I like broccoli, but let's think school lunch broccoli where it's mushy and nasty and gross and nobody wants it. Maybe you got nicer school lunches than I do. I don't know. But just because you put chocolate on it doesn't make it good. So, like, when I was a kid, things like math blasters, yeah, it was better than flashcards. I'll give you that. But it was just flashcards with flashy lights. Whereas an intrinsically motivating game, let's say a Carmen Sandiego, where it was just straight up fun and you wanted to play and you just happened to be learning about social studies as you did it. Those are the kind of games that are meaningful. Kids want to play Minecraft, and then the learning just becomes intrinsic and part of the experience. It's awesome when you can have students learning that way. And in doing so, we need to know who our students are. First rule of teaching, good teaching, is always know your students well, right? And that's the same with games. So different games incentivize in different ways, whether students want to explore or achieve or get something in the game, whether it's social experience, or they want to sort of take something apart and rebel against the game structure. Again, you can dive deeper into that with some other materials, but I think it's important to note all of that. So in my experience in New York City, how do we get Minecraft happening with students? Well, here's the cool thing. The teachers do not have to be good at Minecraft to teach with Minecraft, right? You are the one setting goals. You are the one setting learning objectives, right? That's what I'm doing. I wasn't good at Minecraft. The students were when we first started using it way, way back in the day before it was a thing in education-wise. But that was the thing. I could create the design challenges and say what my expectations were, even if I couldn't have met those expectations yet of building in Minecraft. I would only learn that stuff over time. But that's what's cool about it. The kids were incentivized to do it and go beyond what I even asked of them. So usually where I start with students, especially a lot of my early learners and students with more intense needs, is a sort of personal narrative structure. That's a really great place to begin because they're already beginning with stuff they know themselves. And in this world I've created, they can go ahead and build for me their perception of themselves, their perception of their family, perceptions of a physical structure that indicates things that are important to them, hobbies, their home, interests. And I also often have them build something that they're worried or nervous or don't really like or are fearful of for the year. And yes, that's all a cool thing about how they indicate great all these items and are able to build it and portray it. But the best part of it is that I make it a social experience. So they actually give tours of their world, either through a video or live if we're doing it in a collaborative world, to their peers. And that's where it becomes really intense because that's where the students are made to express all that they are internally. And there starts to build empathy for these students who aren't always really good at that kind of thing. So that's why it's a really great starter for a lot of my students. It's where I like to go right off the bat. I know it may seem simplistic, but it's really meaningful for what our kids do. And then we get into more traditional type of narrative things that happen in Minecraft. Yes, we use it tons for math and science and construction. And we build story settings too, where we'll have some of the older students build complex settings for the stories that they're doing. And then the younger students can go ahead and travel throughout it and experience it. Beyond that though, some of the coolest things I think we've been doing inside of Minecraft are accessible design and universal design for learning experiences. And so our students with disabilities, many of them physical disabilities, are building worlds that are accessible to other people with disabilities. And we model that within the Minecraft world.
Directions, path to right towards home, path straight towards school.
This particular world, along with other accessibly designed spaces like a school and a supermarket, gives directions to visually impaired players of where to go.
6 steps towards home entrance.
It allows students to experiment and determine the design they'll need for the real world.
Entrance, welcome home.
But then we start to design outside of it too. So that's a nice easy space for the students to start and get the understanding of what is it like to empathize with other people who might not have the same challenge as I do, who might have different ones and meet the world differently? What is it like for people who can't just walk to school, right? Who don't have an easy access to a bus? What is it like for people who can't see? How are they going to get through this world? And so all these different types of things are built within those structures, ramps, elevators, voice communication systems are really powerful. We build all these structures for a universally designed space in Minecraft. We can start in the Minecraft and then we start building structures that are accessible in the real world. And so that's really cool that we can build off that experience. Students can start building some simple accessibility tools like a Braille map that can be experienced physically, some accessible forever patient materials that help for like students with motorized chairs, for ramp access, things to help students with physical challenges more easily open up their book bags, and even more complex 3D printed materials that we get into later on, often in the year. Granted, we were doing a lot of 3D printing when we were totally remote, but we have been able to dive back into some of that now that we're in a more hybrid and blended and in-person environment. And beyond that, now that it's in an educational space, Microsoft has helped a lot in making it much more accessible. Yes, there is the Microsoft controller, Xbox controller, which I highly recommend. Super awesome, super accessible. You can tap in all these switches and things to it. And there are a lot of other accessible controllers that we use. If you're interested, reach out to me and I can share more on that for you. But there's also a lot of built-in accessible features for the games, whether it be the special blocks or other accessibility features like text-to-speech or screen readers that interact with the NPCs or text displays to read everything out to any visually impaired player, item descriptions in the screen, zoom features that are accessible, and the ability to document what's happening within the game for students with some more cognitive challenges. That's really meaningful too. Now, I really want to dive into some of the really cool stuff we've done recently. One of the really neat things we've done is I was able to help coordinate a citywide New York City Minecraft design challenge where students were asked to design an accessible, sustainable space within the city or redesign an existing space. And we had so many students submit amazing work, and they honestly didn't have that much time. They only had a few weeks from the beginning of this challenge when we started training teachers all across the city. Again, they didn't have to be experts because the students got the game part. The teachers were explaining the structure. And I have to say, some of the teachers were having some fun playing too. So in that, some students made amazing things. I want to show you a few examples. Here's one from a student who's in eighth grade who redesigned a space that was damaged recently. And I think it sort of speaks for itself.
My name is Glen Tatum, and I have redesigned the Inwood Hill Nature Center in Manhattan's Inwood Hill Park. The center was damaged in 2012 by Hurricane Sandy and never repaired. Located on a peninsula in the park and surrounded by water, this new public space will be called the Inwood Hill Culture and Nature Center. The new center has several features and its two-story plan. At the front entrance, there is an art exhibit and there are several areas of seating. There are multiple nature exhibits along with an area for group instruction and a book library. Going back down the hallway, you can see many windows to allow natural light and views of the park. At the end of the hallway, there is an ADA elevator to go to the second floor. There is also a new outdoor deck over the water. Heading back from the deck into the Nature and Culture Center and past the registration desk, we head up the staircase to the second floor. Here, there is a multi-purpose area that can be used for exercise instruction, music concerts, and small parties. Heading back down the hallway, there is also a small outdoor deck for people to relax and enjoy views of the water. The new Inwood Hill Culture and Nature Center will be a great public space for the people of New York City to come and enjoy with their families and friends.
But if you think it was just that, we had students at all levels. So this is a first grade student. A whole lot of fun their world, but you see that there's a lot of meaningful things happening in it as well.
Hi everybody, my name is Penelope and I'm in the first grade. This is my public space. This is my garden. It is calm and peaceful. Now let's go to the pool. Here is the pool. Here's the cafe, here's the aquarium on the roof. Here is the obstacle course. Be careful, the floor is lava. Now we're here at the petting zoo, we have pigs, horse, and chickens. finally, a nice beach with umbrellas and boats. This public space is important to get exercise and to have fun.
Now, who thinks if I had made her write an essay while it was fully remote, that would be half as good? All right, but we're here just in time for the fireworks.
Thanks for watching. Bye!
It shows how when they're incentivized, they just take it to a whole nother level all by themselves. Beyond that, we've even had partnerships with other organizations. So we've put together sort of Minecraft museums. One of the really neat ones we did was with the Newark Museum of Art, which had to close down, obviously, because of the pandemic. But we were able to rebuild the Newark space with the students. And then we were able to rebuild a bunch of the designs within it. We'll just show you a little bit of what that looked like. The Newark Museum of Art has had to close its doors temporarily, but that doesn't mean there aren't ways you can still experience the museum and the art itself virtually. Yes, the museum and examples of some of its great pieces now exist inside a Minecraft version of the museum.
You can explore familiar places like the Ballantine House, the Museum Garden, or the Horizon Plaza.
You can view art of the ancient Mediterranean, the Americas, the arts of global Africa, or just check out the old stone schoolhouse. If you get lost, there are guidebooks, maps, and museum guides. And if you want to dive deeper, they'll connect you to further resources. But that's just the beginning. We want you to be part of the museum team too. You can create and display your own work of art in the museum. And there are so many other ways we've used it. Of course, the computer science is always awesome. You can start with some of the really simplistic Minecraft coding experiences on code.org, and then you can take it in game and do much more complex stuff. And the tutorials that they have made it really easy for the teachers, honestly. Yes, we would have their kickoff trainings. Yes, I would record a bunch of short form tutorial videos for teachers to help them get involved and understand all the things that we were doing. But more than that, it just, they took it and rolled with it because the kids were having such an amazing time. I think it's important to note that we also had many teachers go into next steps because they were motivated to do so and taken it on and it become certified in the Minecraft community. We've even had a couple of other teachers beside myself become Minecraft mentors within the city, which is really, really cool. And then, yes, we can't have mind fairs in person, but we have had these sort of virtual ones here. We used to be able to tap in with students, and I had my students and my own children come and participate in these awesome events of creativity and collaboration and critical thinking, even with escape rooms. But we're able to do it even digitally now, where we have digital Minecraft escape rooms, we have digital Minecraft parties for students, where they show off their creations, they show off the exhibits. It's a whole lot of fun. And so I guess I'll just leave with this that I always sort of end with, is that no, obviously whenever you take on anything that's new or that's challenging, it's never going to be immediately successful. This Special Olympics oath sort of speaks to that. You will not always win, but you can always bravely attempt whatever it is you're working for. And for us, it was trying to make learning meaningful, engaging, and just worthwhile in a time where there was so much challenge for our students here in New York City and so much sadness, that it was great to bring out this sort of light in them. And we're really grateful for it. So I hope this was meaningful for you, and feel free to reach out to me beyond this. Have a great day, everybody.